Well, the story we're going to be discussing this evening is a very little-known apparition of Our Lady in the town of Quito in Ecuador. And this apparition, although it's very little-known in our days, is extremely important for us today because one of the main topics that Our Lady discussed in this apparition was our very troubled times. She spoke about terrible times coming in the 20th century. In fact, Our Lady made a special request of the visionary in this apparition, Mother Mariana de Jesus Torres, that she offer her prayers and her sacrifices, especially for us in our days. She predicted in detail many of the errors that we see today, the moral problems that we experience on a daily basis. She spoke about a coming chastisement and also a coming restoration of society and the church. So you can see that these apparitions in Quito fit very well together with the apparitions of Our Lady of Fatima. Now, to get a proper perspective on these messages, we have to understand two corollary subjects beforehand because they're inextricably linked to the messages of Our Lady of Good Success in Quito. And the first one we have to understand is the life of the extraordinary visionary who received these messages, Mother Mariana de Jesus Torres. Extraordinary life. The second thing we have to understand is a little bit about the Conceptionist convent in Ecuador that Mother Mariana co-founded and where she lived her whole life. With this background, we'll be able to have a solid foundation to speak about Our Lady of Good Success and the messages that she gave to us, especially for these times. So that's going to be pretty much the outline of the talk. We're going to speak first a little bit about Mother Mariana and about this convent, this Conceptionist convent in Quito, Ecuador. And after that, we're going to speak a little bit about the statue and the messages of Our Lady of Good Success. So is that clear? Before we get started, I don't know if anyone has any questions or comments. Okay, good. So let's talk a little bit about the life of Mother Mariana. Mother Mariana was born in 1563. She was a Spanish lady. She was born in Spain to two Spanish nobles, Don Diego Torres and Dona Maria Berriocoa. And these two nobles were very fervent Catholics. From a very early age, from the extremities of youth, Mother Mariana was a very pious girl. You could say she was an extraordinary girl. She exuded piety. At 6 years old, she was already spending hours every day in front of the Blessed Sacrament, praying, offering sacrifices, like I said, at 6 years old. She was so devoted to the Blessed Sacrament that she was given a very special permission to receive her first communion when she was only 9 years old. Now that doesn't sound like a big deal for us today, but youth communion was only started in the early 1900s by St. Pius X. So that was an extraordinarily early age to receive your first communion. And she was such a special soul that when she received our Lord the first time, she fell into an ecstasy and she received a marvelous vision. And in this vision, she saw a young man who was our Lord Jesus Christ. And she saw the Blessed Trinity. And our Lord went to God the Father and asked permission to become espoused to Mariana. He wanted to become engaged to her. And that obviously made it very clear that she was going to become a nun, because we all know that nuns are brides of Christ. In a mystical way, they're married to Christ himself. So already at 9 years old, she knew that she was going to be a nun. Our Lady came later in this vision, and she told her that she wanted her to become a Conceptionist nun. Now the Conceptionist order is an extraordinary order, and it had just been founded by a Portuguese noble, St. Beatrix of Silva. And the Conceptionists are in reality just a branch of the Franciscans, but their focus, their main focus, is to honor Our Lady through her Immaculate Conception. Many extraordinary nuns throughout history have been Conceptionist nuns. One very notable one is Venerable Maria of Agreda. Has anyone heard of her before? A few have.
Sisi.
She was the one that wrote the perhaps the greatest mystical work on the life of Our Lady in history, which is called The Mystical City of God. Our Lady is called the Mystical City of God. It's where God lives more than any other place. If you haven't heard of that work, you're not familiar with it, I highly suggest getting a copy of it. It's an extraordinary work. So this was a prophetic apparition, a prophetic message that Sister Mariana received, telling her she was going to be a nun, telling her that she was going to be a conceptionist nun. And it didn't take a long time for that prophecy to be fulfilled. Because at that time, when she was 9 years old, 1572, actually a few years earlier than that, the Spanish were in the midst of their conquest and colonization of South America. And they were setting up colonies all throughout South America, and being very Catholic, they obviously always wanted to establish monasteries and convents wherever they went. Because it's within those cloisters that the graces are truly bought for a society to go ahead. And it's something that's throughout church history, it's very interesting. The foundation of true Christian civilization is always cloistered convents and monasteries. So a group of very influential women that were living in this colony in Quito, the Spanish colony, beseeched the King of Spain, who was Philip II at that time, started begging him to bring an order of conceptionist nuns to the colony in Quito. So Philip II was very happy to grant their request, and he sent a very pious nun, whose name was Mother Maria of Jesus Tabuada. She was known for her sanctity. He sent her to lead five other nuns to go to Quito to establish this conceptionist convent. Very not coincidentally, this lady, Mother Maria of Jesus Tabuada, was the aunt of Mariana, the little girl that we've been speaking about. So our Lord appeared to Mariana again. She was still only 9 years old. And he told her, I want you to travel to Ecuador with your aunt. Now you can imagine what that meant. She was only 9 years old at the time. And remember, traveling from Europe to the New World in those days was more dangerous than it is to go to the moon today, literally. So she was asked to say goodbye to her parents. She knew she would never see her family again. Get on this ship with five other nuns to an unknown New World, where they were to set up a convent where she would live the rest of her life. Well, at the beginning of this trip, there were a lot of financial problems, or a lot of difficulties. The trip was postponed for 4 years. But 4 years later, when Mariana was 13, all the things came together, and the ship took off to travel to the New World. And Mariana was on the ship. She was going to fulfill that sacrifice. Well, when the ship was in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, it was hit by an incredible storm, an enormous storm. It was so violent that the ship crew, who were very seasoned sailors, they were used to storms at sea, they totally lost hope that they would be able to withstand that and that they wouldn't shipwreck. Now, obviously, the ship's crew attributed this storm to natural causes, but in fact, it was not a natural storm. It was something that was caused by the devil in order to stop the foundation of this convent. And that was proved because little Mariana and her aunt, when the storm broke off, they saw a massive serpent in the sea that was attacking the ship. Now, this wasn't just a regular sea snake. It had seven heads, and in Mariana's words, it was bigger than the sea. So this was an incredibly mystical event that was taking place. The devil was trying to shipwreck these nuns so that they couldn't establish this convent in the New World. When Mariana saw this serpent that was attacking the ship, you can imagine a 13-year-old girl, anyone for that matter, would be terrified, absolutely terrified. And Mariana was. She was so frightened, she screamed and she fainted. And when she fainted, she saw a vision. And the vision, she saw exactly what her aunt was seeing, who was still conscious, this enormous serpent attacking the ship, but she saw a beautiful lady in the sky as well. It was the Blessed Virgin. And Our Lady had a necklace, and her necklace was a monstrance with the Blessed Sacrament in it. In one of her hands, she held the child Jesus, and in the other, she held a golden cross. There was something special about this cross, and that is the end of the cross was a lance point. It was a weapon. And Our Lady looked down at the serpent, and proceeded to take this cross weapon, and she anchored it against the Blessed Sacrament, the monstrance. And the child Jesus grabbed onto it as well. And the two of them together slew the serpent that was there. They hit it in the heads, and the heads burst asunder, and it died. At that very moment, the seas were entirely tranquil, and the storm ended. What was bizarre about the whole thing is not just the visionaries, everybody on the ship at that moment heard a terrible voice screaming out, saying this. He said, "I will not allow this foundation to come about." Speaking of the covenant. "I will not allow its progress. I will not allow it to exist until the end of time, and I will persecute it." So, like I said, this was an extraordinary event. And it was only through the action of Our Lady that the seas were calmed. And the trip continued on. I like to tell that story at the beginning because you're going to notice in our story that the story of this convent in Quito, the story of Our Lady of Good Success, is this constant struggle between good and evil. The convent suffered terrible persecutions from the government, internal revolutions, all sorts of things, but Our Lady was always there guiding it and putting it back on tracks. So when the group arrived in South America, their voyage was not over. They still had to travel across South America, climb over a whole mountain range to reach the city of Quito, Ecuador. The city of Quito, Ecuador is over 9,000 feet elevation. It's one of the highest cities in the world, almost twice as high as Denver. So they had to climb this mountain. They got to the end. Finally, their voyage was over, and they installed their new convent. Everything was set up for them already. It's a beautiful convent, and it's enormous. It takes up a whole city block. And if I'm not mistaken, the convent used to be twice the size that it is now. So when they arrived, they established themselves in the convent. Mariana was too young to enter the novitiate. She wasn't old enough yet. So she entered as a postulant. She lived with the nuns. She did certain things with the nuns, but she was not actually a nun. It wasn't until 2 years later, on October 4th, 1579, which was yesterday, the feast of St. Francis of Assisi. That's obviously a very important feast day for the Conceptionists because, like I said, they're a branch of the Franciscans. She made her final vows and became a full member of the order. And immediately her reputation for sanctity started to establish itself. She was a very holy nun, and she was known for keeping the very strict rule that the Conceptionists had to keep perfectly. She was a model nun. Well, during her life in the convent, she continued to receive visions and messages. And meanwhile, she fulfilled many of the different functions in a convent, because a convent to succeed, to exist, there are many different tasks that must be fulfilled. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you just a few little stories that show how perfectly she fulfilled her duties and the miracles she started performing when she was still just a young girl of 16 and 17 years old. The first function she had was nurse in the infirmary. And during her time there, one of the fellow nuns who worked in the kitchen was caught up in a very bad kitchen fire they had there. She was burned extremely badly. In fact, she was burned down to the bone on one of her arms and half of her face. The doctors came in, And they diagnosed her. They looked at her, and they said, "There's no hope for this nun to live, none whatsoever." They said, "We can't repair the damage that's done, and gangrene will very soon set in, and it'll poison her blood, and she'll die." So the nun was obviously very, very frightened about dying. And the only consolation she had in this time was Mother Mariana, Sister Mariana at this time. So Mariani would sit with her for long hours, consoling her, trying to help her, and oftentimes they would cry together over the fate of this nun. What was extraordinary about this was from time to time, Mariana's tears would fall on the nun's wounds, and they started to regenerate the wounds. So much so that within 1 month, the nun was released from the infirmary without a single scar. All of her flesh grew back, and she was absolutely perfect within 1 month. Extraordinary story. So shortly later, Mariana became the purveyor of the convent. Now, the purveyor is the one that has to go out and purchase food, all the necessities of the convent. You can imagine trying to start something like that in the new world. Many times they were very short on funds. Many times they didn't even have enough money to buy food for the convent. And several times, when Mariana served as purveyor, all she had to do was touch the food and start to distribute it, and it would miraculously multiply, just like the miracle of the loaves and the fishes. Several times she did this. She was known for that. Several other times, when the convent didn't have enough money to buy any food, she would go before the Blessed Sacrament, and within minutes, someone would show up at the door with a donation of money or food. So she became, obviously, you can see she's solving all these problems. She became very well known amongst the nuns. They knew she was a saint. They were very happy because she was fulfilling their needs. No one was going hungry when Mariana was the purveyor. Well, a short time after that, she became sacristan. And due to her extreme penances, her life was one of incredible penances. One of the penances she did was sleep deprivation. She never slept more than 3 hours a night. Many nights she only slept for 1 hour. Many of us who have suffered with insomnia know how terrible that can be. So because of that, when she was praying before the Blessed Sacrament, many times she'd fall asleep. And she'd wake up, and the sacristy light would be out. And she felt terrible about it, but she was exhausted. She plainly and simply couldn't stay awake. So she prayed to her guardian angel. She said, look, don't let this happen again. I have to keep the sacristy lamp lit. It's your responsibility to help me out with this. So from then on, whenever the light would go out, her guardian angel would wake her up and say, it's time to relight the sanctuary lamp. And obviously Mariana was Spanish, and the Spanish have a very fiery temperament. She would complain to her guardian angel. She'd say, why did you wake me up? You can light it. You can light it again yourself. What's wrong with you? Why don't you just take care of this problem? Why do I have to do it? Other times, she would come into the chapel and the sacristy lamp would be out and she wouldn't be able to find matches or anything to relight it. So she would tell her guardian angel to relight it for her and he would do it. So it was an extraordinary life that Mother Mariana led. And the fame of her sanctity started to spread outside the convent. And it spread most during one time when Mariana was the liaison with the outside world. Because they lived a very strict cloister. Many convents, you're able to have some contact with the outside world through a screen. I don't know if you've ever visited a convent, but you'll go to a certain area where they visit, and they'll have a screen, so you can't touch the nun, but you can see her and you can talk to her. The Conceptionists were so strict, they didn't even have that. You were never allowed to see anyone that was living outside the cloister. What they did have was a turntable, because the nuns would make things, and they would have to transfer them outside of the convent, so they could be sold, and they had to receive donations and different things that were coming in. So they had one section of the convent, they had this big wooden turntable, and it had sections. And they would put things in, they wanted to transfer out, and they'd rotate it around, and people would get it. And people would put things on the outside, they'd rotate it, and they would take them. So it was a very tight cloister, but the only problem was this turntable was not soundproof. So obviously you've got a very holy convent there, it's filled with holy nuns. The people of Quito would go there quite often just to talk to the nuns. There was one nun who had to sit there all day and communicate with the outside world. And Mariana followed that task for several years. She was in there. And when that took place, it was amazing. People were astounded with the counsels that she would give. She would instruct them on how they were supposed to resolve the problems they had. She became very well known, and her sanctity started to spread throughout the whole colony in Quito. She became very well known. Now, these are very beautiful stories. These are very extraordinary things that happened, but the most extraordinary aspect of Mother Mariana's young life was the fact that she died twice during her young life and resurrected both times. And the first time was when she was 19 years old. And she was praying before the Blessed Sacrament, and all of the lights in her vision turned off in the church. The only light was on the main altar, and it was illuminating the tabernacle. And in her vision, the tabernacle opened up, and our Lord on his cross emerged from the tabernacle. She saw our Lord was suffering intently, just profusely, a lot of suffering. And he had three swords hanging above his head. And each of the swords had a saying on it. The first sword said, I will punish heresy. The second sword said, I will punish blasphemy. And the third sword said, I will punish impurity. And Mariana, of course, was very taken with love of our Lord, and immediately she attributed his sufferings to herself. She thought she was the cause of it. And when she said this, Our Lady comforted her and said, no, it's not your sins that are making our Lord suffer so much. It's the sins that will be committed in the 20th century. Especially those three sins, heresy, blasphemy, and impurity. And Our Lady said, would you like to suffer these three swords in place of my divine son? Mariana immediately agreed to do so, and those three swords plunged into her heart, and she received so much pain at that she died instantly. The next day, the nuns came in to sing, and the office in the morning, and they saw her laying dead on the floor. She was cold to the touch. She was absolutely cold. They brought a doctor in. The doctor immediately examined her, and she was dead. So they laid her out in her room in preparation for burial. And during this time, all of the people that knew her in the city wanted to come in and visit her body. They wanted to pay their respects. They wanted to venerate her body because they truly believed that she was a saint. One of the people who visited her body was another monk from the city of Quito. And he had a tremendous fame of sanctity as well. So he went and he prayed before her body, and he received a vision of what was taking place at that time. What happened was, Mariana's soul was taken to heaven. And while she was there, he saw God the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, the Blessed Trinity, judge her. And the Trinity told her that you right now can spend the rest of eternity in heaven. You don't have to suffer anymore. He said, but I have two separate crowns for you. One crown was a crown of gold, which would be her eternal reward. The other one was of beautiful lilies, but the lilies were covered with thorns. And depending on which crown she accepted, if she accepted the gold one, she'd go straight to heaven. If she accepted the crown of thorns with the lilies, she would come back to earth to suffer more, specifically for the sins of the 20th century, which was what led to her death in the first place. So our Lord gave her this option, and he said, which do you choose? Mother Mariana, being very humble, always wanting to do God's will, said, you choose for me. And our Lord told her, no, I'm not going to choose. He said, I want to put you to the test. I want to see how much you love me. You have to choose on your own. And at that point, Our Lady intervened, and she said, for me, I prefer that you imitate me and go back to earth to suffer for sinners. And when Our Lady said that, Mariana decided to come back to earth and suffer. She lived a long life. This was at the beginning. She suffered another 40-something years, even 50 years, on this earth, rather than staying in heaven forever. It's interesting, just as a side note, Our Lady said, I want you to imitate me. Many people don't realize Our Lady was given the same choice. When our Lord died, resurrected, and during the ascension, Our Lady was brought to heaven with him so that together they could open the gates of heaven that had been closed to humanity since the sin of Adam and Eve. And when she entered heaven with her divine son after the ascension, our Lord gave her the same choice. Do you want to stay here with me for all eternity, or do you want to go back to earth to suffer more for the salvation of souls? And Our Lady decided to come back and suffer for us. So that was the first time she died and resurrected. Second time was 6 years later. This time she received the stigmata while she was in prayer, and she collapsed from the pain of it. And she, from that moment, began to suffer a very tremendous illness. She was taken to the infirmary, and she was paralyzed over her whole body, except for her mouth and her eyes. Everything else was paralyzed. 5 months later, she regained the use of her arms, but only that. But her sufferings continued. After a year of being bedridden in this horrible state, she died again. This time, the fame of her sanctity was such that everybody in the town and all of the nuns started praying that she would resurrect again, because they didn't want to lose her. And once again, This time, she had died on Friday. They were going to bury her on Monday. On Sunday morning, when the nuns went in to sing the morning office, matins at 4 in the morning, they found Mother Mariana kneeling in her choir stall, ready to sing, praying. They were petrified because they came in and they saw this dead nun kneeling there and praying. They were scared. Mariana jumped up. She wanted to embrace them. You know, I'm back. You know, let's rejoice a little bit. They all ran out of the choir. You can imagine. You can imagine what that was like. But when they went down to where her body was laid out, they saw that the body wasn't there, the shroud was thrown aside, and they started to realize that indeed she had resurrected a second time. And then they went up and they congratulated her, whatnot. So this is very much some of the miraculous events. Understanding Mother Mariana, you have to understand that she was a mystic. And many aspects of her life were tremendously mystical. And to a certain extent, she kind of gave an aura of mysticism all around her. She was extremely close to our Lord and our Lady. Very special vocation. Well, when Mariana was 30 years old, her aunt, who had served as the abbess of the convent the whole time, she retired. She was very sickly, and she couldn't continue to carry out all of the tremendous tasks and responsibilities. She couldn't take the pressure anymore of being abbess because of her health. So she stepped down, and she recommended that Mariana be elected as abbess of the convent. And she was, in fact. She was 30 years old, which is extremely young to be elected as abbess. And she didn't want any part of it. She did not want to be abbess. She didn't think she was up to the task. But they actually commanded her, under holy obedience, that she accept the role as abbess, and she became abbess. The Conceptionist abbesses serve a 3-year term, and then there's another election every 3 years. So she fulfilled her first 3 years, things went rather calmly, and she was hoping she wouldn't be elected again, but she was. So at 33 years, she started her second term as abbess of the convent. During this time, she had tons of trouble within the convent, because there was an enormous dispute within the convent at that time between one faction of nuns who wanted to make their rule easier. They wanted to laxen it. And in order to do that, they wanted to break off their relationship with the Franciscan convent that was there in Quito. Because up until that time, the Franciscan monks were the ones that had charge of the convent. They determined what took place. They had control over the inner activities of the convent, and they were very strict. They adhered very strictly to the Franciscan rule. Some of the nuns wanted to break that relationship and put themselves directly under the bishop, which would give them a lot more liberty to do whatever they wanted. It would make things much easier for them. And there was one nun who was indigenous. It was an Indian. And they gave her the name of La Capitana, which means the captain. And she was a very evil nun. And she was very, very intent on breaking away from the Franciscans. And she got a whole group of the nuns within the convent to follow her. And they started doing terrible things. At a certain point, they wanted to rebel and openly revolt. So they determined that they were going to break out of the cloister of the convent. Break cloister. I told you how securely locked the cloister was. They got torches and they were going to break out and parade through the streets of Quito demanding that they be put under the bishop. What was interesting about this case was when they entered the room that led to the door that led outside the cloister, there was a statue of Our Lady there. And when they passed the statue of Our Lady turned her head away from them. The statue actually turned its head. Afterwards, La Capitana, this woman, sawed the head off and had it replaced, glued back on, looking straight ahead. When you go to the convent, you can see the saw line where the head was cut off of the statue. That's how bad this one was. So even seeing that miracle, she was still determined to go out in the streets. And she got to the door. She had the key wouldn't work, and they couldn't open the door. They brought crowbars in, they did everything. Mother Mariana then found out what they were doing and went down there and calmed them and sent them back to their room. So after all of this, La Capitana was still not happy. She was intent on bringing Mother Mariana down because Mother Mariana, as abbess, was a sign of the strict rule of the adherence to the Franciscans. So she created all of these lies against Mother Mariana and went straight to the bishop and spewed out a whole series of lies about Mariana. What happened was, because of this, Mariana was deposed as abbess, and another nun was substituted for her, Mother Valenzuela. So when that took place, the bishop did something which might be shocking to our modern ears. He had her put in prison, Mother Mariana, because all convents used to have a prison there. And for very bad violations, the nun would actually be put in the prisons. Monasteries had the exact same thing. So she was in prison for 3 days. And from within the prison, she was only let out to eat her meals. And when she ate her meals, they took the utensils away from her and put her plate on the floor. So she had to kneel on the floor and eat like an animal. A very strict punishment that she was given. 3 days later, she was let out of prison because the bishop only had her in prison for 3 days. And after that, they kept making her eat on the floor. They continued to do that. When this happened, they were persecuting her. Remember, there were 5 other foundresses that came from Spain to found the monastery. Seeing this injustice, they couldn't take it anymore. So they started to support Mariana. They started to bring her things. They started to comfort her. And the new mother superior, who was influenced very much by this bad nun, La Capitana, had Mariana and the other 5 nuns, the other 5 foundresses, thrown back in prison for a month. Now, she did this without the knowledge of anyone on the outside. The bishop didn't even know about it. So the 6 of these nuns, the holiest members of the convent, in fact, all 6 of these nuns are incorrupt. You can see their bodies if you go to the convent in Quito. All 6 of them were locked up, and a contingent of about 20 of the other nuns living there came to their support. They stood up against what was being done to them, so the Mother Superior had all of them locked up with her. So at this point, there were 25 nuns, the most faithful nuns in the convent, were locked up in prison. In order to support them in this difficult time they were suffering, Our Lady gave a vision to each of the 6 nuns one of the nights when they were there in prison. Now, I'm not going to go through all 6 of them. We don't have that much time, but one of them I will mention because it deals with St. Francis himself. And one of the things that angers me a lot is the way that St. Francis of Assisi is often portrayed. He's portrayed as a pacifist, someone that you know, would give in to anyone, not someone who fought against evil. One of the nuns, which nun was it? I've got it here somewhere. Mother Francisca, named after St. Francis, she received a vision of St. Francis. And St. Francis during his lifetime was not pacifist at all. In fact, he supported the crusade that took place during his lifetime. So Mother Francisca saw a vision of St. Francis walking through the halls of the convent with a bow and arrow, shooting arrows. And St. Francis, at a certain point, pointed out one of the rebellious nuns, and he said, "She's the worst of them all." And he shot her with an arrow. And in this vision, she fell dead. The next morning, that nun was dead. Her skin had turned totally black. She was already starting to putrefy. Pretty impressive story of St. Francis. He wasn't the pushover that we sometimes envision him to have been. Well, during this time, like I said, nobody outside the convent knew the persecution that these nuns were suffering, but there was one canon, one priest of the cathedral, who started to get very suspicious that something was up. So he started going every day to the convent asking to speak with Mother Mariana. And the nuns kept making excuses. "No, she's busy. No, she can't talk to you," this and that. And after the 3rd day, he said, "Okay, something serious is going on here." So finally he went to the bishop. He explained to him something very strange was happening inside the convent. The bishop came to visit and saw what they were doing. And at that moment, the Mother Superior, who was a very weak soul, but deep down a very good soul, she explained everything, what had happened. that all the lies against Mother Mariana were not true. And the bishop was so furious, he took all of the nuns out of prison, reinstated Mariana as the abbess, and took La Capitana, that evil nun that was causing all these problems, and had her in prison for life. He said, you're going to live in the prison from now on. Now, La Capitana obviously was a very bad person, and she didn't take her punishment very lightly. So when she was in the prison, she would go into these rages of fury. She would bang her head against the wall. She would scream blasphemies. She was so bad, none of the nuns would even go in to bring her food because they were afraid of her. They said, this nun is possessed by a devil. I don't want to be near her. The only nun that would go to her, talk to her, bring her food was Mother Mariana, who she had persecuted so much. And Mariana continued to pray for this nun. She continued to offer sacrifices that this nun could somehow be saved. And at a certain point, that nun became extremely sick. And she was allowed to leave the prison and go in the infirmary. And from the infirmary, Mother Mariana would come to care for her in her sickness. She would spit on Mother Mariana. She'd throw her food at Mother Mariana. She would take boiling cups of soup and throw them at her. She would take the medicine and throw it at Mother Mariana. So in this state, Mother Mariana started redoubling her prayers for the conversion of this nun. Finally, she received a vision, and God told Mariana, there's only one way you can save the soul of this nun, because she merits hell, and that is if you suffer hell in her place. She said, what I'm asking you to do if you really want to save this nun is you will suffer the pains of hell for 5 years while you're working in your convent. And if you do that, I'll save this nun, but I'm still going to make her spend until the end of time in purgatory. And Mother Mariana joyfully accepted it. Now, how can this be? It sounds very strange that she would suffer the pains of hell while living on earth, but that's in fact what happened. Obviously, there are two main sufferings in hell. The first one is the pain of sense, where you're burning, all the tastes in your mouth are terrible, you hear blasphemies, you smell the most atrocious smells, all of these pains that you have in your senses. These pains were very slightly diminished in Mariana just so she could continue to function inside the convent. What was not diminished at all is the worst part of hell, which is the total deprivation of God. Totally cut off with God, even though you realize that every inclination you have is made for God. It's the most agonizing pain that exists in hell. Mother Mariana suffered that to its highest degree, and even suffered the despair of hell, because when she was in that state, she couldn't imagine that this would ever end. She thought it was going to last forever, like the souls in hell do. During those 5 years, she continued to serve La Capitana in the infirmary, getting soup thrown on her, being spat upon, all of the things that La Capitana was doing to her. And she never lost her patience with her once, continued to serve her. Finally, at one point, years into this whole ordeal, La Capitana was finally touched by a grace and started to convert. But when she converted, she realized that all the punishments that she was receiving were merited. She realized it was justified. She deserved everything she was getting. And she started to be weighed down by a guilty conscience, which was making her suffer more than her sickness was. Once again, the only nun that went to comfort her was Mother Mariana. She supported her. Long and short of it is, this nun ended up becoming a very good nun, a pious nun. And actually, she outlived Mother Mariana. She lived 1 year longer. And that nun was the one that prepared Mariana's body for burial. So that's a little bit about Mother Mariana. We've spoken a little bit about the convent. All of these things were full of struggles. They were full of difficulties, just like the apparition at the beginning. The devil said, I'm going to persecute this convent all the days that it exists. That's a very long introduction to start talking about Our Lady of Good Success. I think it's an important introduction because you understand the sanctity that was involved in the coming of Our Lady to this convent in Quito, Ecuador. So in the midst of this incredible life, Mother Mariana began to receive visions of Our Lady under the invocation, Our Lady of Good Success. That's the invocation of Our Lady there, because that's how Our Lady defined herself. When she came the first time, she said, I am Mary of Good Success, Queen of Heaven and Earth. What does that mean, good success? When you think about good success, you think it's Our Lady you pray to when you want to have a business deal to go through well. That's not what the invocation means. Good success is an ancient invocation to Our Lady. And what it refers to is the good success Our Lady had in bringing the child Jesus to term during her pregnancy. That's the good success. The fact that from the incarnation, when Our Lord was made flesh in her womb, until the time of birth, it was a successful pregnancy. She carried Our Lord and finally gave birth to Him. After that, obviously, it's taken on other meanings. Certainly success in any type of venture, but the true meaning, the core meaning of it is that. And that's why Our Lady of Good Success is a very popular invocation for women who are having trouble with childbirth, and having trouble with pregnancies. They pray to Our Lady of Good Success, since she successfully brought the child Jesus to term. So the visions of Our Lady of Good Success started February 2nd, 1594. And Mother Mariana was praying prostrate in the chapel at that time. And a beautiful lady appeared. And Mother Mariana asked her, she said, who are you, beautiful lady? And why do you come to me, who is a nun that loves God very much, but is afflicted with great sufferings? And Our Lady said, I am Mary of Good Success. I'm Queen of Heaven and Earth. And I have come here to comfort you in the midst of your sufferings. So Our Lady, through the invocation of Good Success, started to make extraordinary prophecies. She prophesied that the Franciscans would lose their hold on the convent in Quito, which actually happened during the life of Mother Mariana. She made incredible prophecies. We're going to talk about the prophecies, more of the prophecies at the end of the talk. But I do want to mention that one. She prophesied the Franciscans. She said the government and many different factors would try to destroy this convent all throughout the ages, but I will never allow them to destroy this convent. She said the convent would last till the end of time. Many persecutions came to close down the convent in Quito. The most recent one was in 1990. The government tried to shut down the convent again and were unsuccessful in doing so. So for throughout history up until this point, and we can have confidence until the end, Our Lady has a special protection over that convent. She will not allow it to take place. One of the extraordinary prophecies Our Lady made was she said there will always be a saint living in this convent throughout all time. I visited the convent, and actually I went inside the cloister to bring the statue back. And it's funny, I was trying to figure out which one is the saint. Obviously, I couldn't tell, but we can have confidence that there is a saint living there right now, and there always will be one there. So Our Lady appeared to her many times giving these prophecies. Like I said, we're going to go through some of these prophecies later, but one of the tragic aspects of these prophecies was Mariana wrote down all of the messages she received in a booklet. It's called the Cuaderno. Cuaderno in Spanish, of course, means notebook. And in 1710, one of the times that the convent was being persecuted, one of the nuns hid that cuaderno, all those messages, in one of the walls of the convent. And she died without it becoming public knowledge where those writings are. So to this day, the bulk of the messages of Our Lady of Good Success are in the walls of the convent somewhere. Nobody knows where they are. We do know several of the prophecies, and like I said, we'll be going through those in just a minute here. So the second apparition took place when Mother Mariana was in prison. Remember, she was imprisoned by La Capitana. And when Our Lady came to her this time, she said, look, I want you to make a statue that represents me exactly as I'm appearing to you right now. And she said, I want it to be identical. I want it to be the same height. I want everything to be the same. And she explained how she was appearing and what it meant. This is a picture right here, I know you can't see it very well, of the statue that was finally made, the miraculous statue. And she explained that I'm holding the child Jesus in my left arm because I want people who see the statue to know the strength I have in holding back my divine son's justice, which is what sinners deserve. I'm powerful to do that. I can hold him back. She said, I'm holding a crozier in my right hand. And it's a little known thing, but if you notice, the crozier closes in upon itself like that. That's the kind of crozier that only the heads of monasteries and convents use, because it's closed in upon itself. That means that their authority is just within the convent. If you look at a bishop, his crozier curves over and then curves out again, showing that his authority reaches out over his whole diocese. Our Lady, who's Queen of Heaven and Earth and proclaimed herself as such, has a crozier that circles in. And she explained the reason for that was, she said, I personally want to serve as the abbess of this convent until the end of time. And I want the statue to have a crozier like that, so all of my nuns in this convent realize that I'm the one that's reigning over them. It's very beautiful. So she even said, she said, I want you to make the statue just like I'm appearing right now. And she said, I want it to be the same height. And so you remember the height. She said, take off your cincture, that's the rope that the Franciscans wear around their waist, and measure me with it. Now obviously Mariana's waist was not as far around as Our Lady was tall. So Our Lady took the cincture and held it to her forehead, and it miraculously got longer until it was exactly the height that Our Lady was appearing. And if you're curious, Our Lady's statue measured from that crozier is 5'9". So very tall, very tall. Especially in those days, the indigenous people in Ecuador are very short. So it was a very imposing statue, very, very tall. Well, as often happens in these cases, Mariana did not have the statue made right away. She was frightened. She thought the bishop wouldn't listen to him, so she delayed and delayed and delayed until Our Lady came another time. And she appeared with a very stern look on her face, and she rebuked Mariana. She said, why didn't you have this done? And Mariana made excuses, and she said, no excuses. You're going to have this statue made. And Mariana said, well, I lost the cord. I don't know how tall you are anymore. And she said, well, take off your cincture right now and measure me again. The miracle was repeated a second time. And Our Lady even said, she said, there's a certain artist living in Quito. She gave his name. She said, I want him to make my statue because he's a very virtuous soul and he practices the Ten Commandments. So with that warning, that rebuking from Our Lady, Mariana said, okay, I better do this thing. She went to the bishop and he was very supportive. He immediately contracted that artist to start carving Our Lady's statue, and the carving was begun. Right when the statue was almost finished, you can imagine this artist was overwhelmed when he found out that Our Lady had asked him specifically to carve the statue. So he wanted to make sure he did it the best way possible. He was very conscientious. And when it came time to put the last coat of paint and finish on the statue, he said, I can't find, she said, Our Lady deserves the best paints that exist in the world. So he said, I'm leaving for 2 or 3 weeks. I'm going to go throughout Europe and I'm going to find the best paints that exist in the world. And I'm going to come back and I'm going to use those to finish painting the face of Our Lady. And that was what gave rise to another extraordinary miracle of the statue. Because when he was gone, when he was procuring these paints, the statue was finished by the three archangels. It's a very beautiful story. Mother Mariana once again was praying, prostrate in the chapel, with the unfinished statue there. And while she was praying, she saw another vision of Our Lady of Good Success. And together with Our Lady, St. Francis was there, the Holy Trinity was there, and the three archangels, St. Michael, St. Gabriel, and St. Raphael, were all there present. Mother Mariana watched as the three archangels finished the work on the statue. After that, Our Lady of Good Success walked into the statue, and the statue became animated. And from within the statue, she turned towards the Blessed Sacrament and sang the Magnificat. Then St. Francis, again, we're talking about cinctures, he took his cincture off and he put it around Our Lady as a sign that he was giving her total control over his convent. It was an extraordinary, extraordinary event. The next morning, when all the nuns came in to sing office, once again, they saw the statue completed there. They were blown away. And very shortly thereafter, the artist came back, And he couldn't believe what had happened. He said, human hands could not have done this. And he immediately signed a legal document saying that he did not finish the statue and signed it. And he got the bishop, because the bishop was following the work on the statue step by step. He was very enthusiastic about the statue. And the bishop also signed a legal affidavit saying that this was not done by human hands, the completion of the statue. So it's very well documented. Another aspect that's very amazing is this happened 500 years ago. The statue's never been retouched. The way it is right now is exactly the same finish that it originally had. So throughout the life of the statue is extremely miraculous. I mean, all sorts of stories about it. At one point, the nuns complained to Our Lady because they couldn't take care of their garden where they grew their food and sing the divine, they sing the little office to Our Lady. They couldn't do both at the same time. They didn't have enough time. And Our Lady appeared and said, keep singing the office and I'll take care of the garden. And every morning when the nuns went in to pray, the seam of the dress on the statue was wet with dew and the gardening was totally taken care of. One of the most recent well-documented miracles happened in the early 1900s. The statue was down in the main church, and in the midst of Mass, the statue became animate, started blinking her eyes, and started looking around to all the people. It lasted for several hours, and then it stopped. And actually, the Mother Superior, who is the abbess right now, when she first entered the convent, she spoke to many people who had witnessed that miracle. This is in our days. So this is all of the other miracles. The most impressive thing is the list of prophecies that Our Lady made. I hope this gives you a solid foundation to understand these prophecies. I want to read for you a couple of these prophecies, and you'll see how perfectly they relate to us today. It's something that's absolutely amazing. The first one, which unfortunately I couldn't find the exact quote, but one of the things that was prophesied was Our Lady spoke about World War II. Remember, this was in the 1500s. She spoke about World War II, and she said, the Pope who was Pope during this great war will also proclaim the dogma of my assumption into heaven. Obviously, Pope Pius XII was Pope during World War II, and in 1950, he proclaimed the dogma of the assumption of Our Lady. Similarly, she prophesied the Pope who would proclaim her Immaculate Conception and also the papal infallibilities. And I do have the exact quote. She said, the Pope's infallibility will be declared a dogma of faith by the same Pope chosen to proclaim the dogma of the mystery of my Immaculate Conception. That was Pope Pius IX. He proclaimed both dogmas. She said, he will be persecuted and imprisoned in the Vatican through the usurpation of the pontifical states and through the malice, envy, and avarice of earthly monarchs. That happened during the reign of Pius IX. He called himself a prisoner in the Vatican because the papal states were usurped from him by Garibaldi. You all have heard of Garibaldi. So Our Lady predicted this exactly as it was going to take place. Another thing she said, during the 20th century, unbridled passions will give way to a total corruption of customs because Satan will reign through the Masonic sects, targeting the children in particular to ensure general corruption. Unhappy the children of those times. Seldom will they receive the sacraments of baptism and confirmation. As for the sacrament of penance, they will confess only while attending Catholic schools, which the devil will do his utmost to destroy by means of persons in authority. That's exactly what happens in our days. How many people do you know that went to Catholic schools and never went to confession after they graduated from Catholic school? They stopped practicing the faith. She went through all of the sacraments one by one and told how they would be disfigured in the 20th century. She said this, the same will occur with Holy Communion. Oh, how it hurts me to tell you that there will be many and enormous public and hidden sacrileges. We see the profanation of the Blessed Sacrament everywhere today, publicly. Talk about hidden. Talk to anybody who cleans a church. The terrible things that happen. I know I spoke to the one of the ladies that used to clean the church at a Catholic school when I was growing up, and she said they found hosts all the time inside the song booklets. They found them stuck underneath the pew. The student had taken them out of her mouth and stuck it while it was wet underneath the pew. That happened frequently. It was normal that it happened. Another extraordinary prediction Our Lady made was, she said this. She said, in the 19th century, a truly Christian president will come, a man of character to whom God our Lord will grant the palm of martyrdom in this very square where my convent is. He will consecrate the Republic to the Sacred Heart of my beloved son, and this consecration will sustain the Catholic religion throughout the following years. During those years, which will be ominous for the Church, the accursed sect of Freemasonry will take over the civil government. A cruel persecution will rage against all religious communities and will descend upon this convent with special fury. That happened to the letter of the law. In the 19th century, in the mid-19th century, there was a president in Quito, Quito is the capital, in Ecuador, named Gabriel Garcia Moreno. And he did exactly what Our Lady said. He consecrated Ecuador to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. He built a huge, beautiful basilica there, commemorating the consecration of Ecuador to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. She said, who will be given the palm of martyrdom on this very square. He was martyred. He was hacked to death by enemies of the church with machetes right in front of where the convent is situated. The convent is in the central square of the city of Quito, right next to the presidential palace. And it's interesting because Garcia Moreno was a very Catholic president. And one of the things he did, it was later confessed by these conspirators, that this was the straw that broke the camel's back, that said, we have to persecute this man, we have to kill him, because we can't have a president that's that Catholic. What he did was, during the Holy Week procession in Quito, I can't remember who it was, one of the gentlemen that participated and organized it was speaking to the president. He said, it's really a shame because we've never had a president participate in our Holy Week demonstration. It'd be nice if a president would carry a cross in the Holy Week procession. When the Holy Week procession came that day, Garcia Moreno came with his shoes off and carried a massive cross all throughout the streets in official recognition of the president, honoring the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. When the Masonic sects who were trying to eradicate Catholicism from Ecuador saw that, they said, that's it. We cannot allow this man to continue. It's very beautiful because he accepted his martyrdom. Months before, what would be the Secret Service of Ecuador at that time came to him and they said, I don't know how they addressed the president, but they said, you know, Mr. President, or however they did, there are people that want to kill you. We need to increase your bodyguards. And Garcia Moreno said, no, don't do it. He said, they can kill me, but God does not die. God does not die. And after he was hacked apart in the square with machetes and shot, those were his last words, God does not die. It's very beautiful. The people of Ecuador, he was very popular, they took the body of Garcia Moreno while it was still living. He was in his death throes, and they brought it into the cathedral, which is right next door, and they set him on the floor right in front of the altar of Our Lady of Sorrows. And that's where Garcia Moreno died. So it's another prophecy that Our Lady spoke about, which did take place. I know we're going a little bit long here, but I'm going to skip ahead a little bit here. She said, at the end of the 19th century and throughout a great part of the 20th century, many heresies will be propagated in these lands. You saw the rise of Protestantism in Ecuador, a totally Catholic country, not even to mention modernism, which is the worst of all heresies, which is rampant throughout Ecuador, just like it's rampant throughout the United States. She said, the small number of souls who will secretly safeguard the treasure of the faith and virtues will suffer a cruel, unspeakable, and long martyrdom. She's talking about us, people that maintain the faith in the midst of all this adversity. It's like a long, prolonged martyrdom. She said, many will descend to the grave through the violence of suffering and will be counted amongst the martyrs who sacrifice themselves for the country and for the church. So in heaven, the people that really are persecuted for the faith on this earth in our days, even if they're not martyred here on earth, they're given a crown of martyrdom in heaven. She said, to be delivered from the slavery of these heresies, those whom the merciful love of my Son has destined for this restoration will need great willpower, perseverance, courage, and confidence in God to try the faith and trust. Of these just ones, there will be times when all will seem lost and paralyzed. That's right now. Everything seems lost and paralyzed. It will then be the happy beginning of the complete restoration of all things. She said, in those times, the atmosphere will be saturated with the spirit of impurity, which, like a filthy sea, will engulf the streets and public places with incredible license. Imagine the immorality we see on the streets today. Innocence will scarcely be found in children, and modesty will scarcely be found in women. He's talking about our days right now. Right now. He said, he who should speak out against this will remain silent. There shall be scarcely any virgin souls in the world. The delicate flower of virginity will seek refuge in the cloisters. Without virginity, fire from heaven will be needed to purify these lands. So that practice of purity is something that holds back the divine hand of justice. Because you don't find it anymore today. You see that it inhabits all places. Another thing she said, the sacrament of matrimony, which symbolizes the union of Christ with his church, will be thoroughly attacked and profaned. Masonry, then reigning, will implement iniquitous laws aimed at extinguishing this sacrament. They will make it easy for all to live in sin, thus multiplying the birth of illegitimate children without the church's blessings. Think of the enormous rates of cohabitation today. Our Lady foresaw this in the 1500s. One more prophecy I think I'm going to read, and then we'll finish here. She said, sex, having permeated all social classes, that's S-E-C-T-S, sex, will find ways in introducing themselves into the very heart of homes to corrupt the innocence of children. The children's hearts will be dainty morsels to regale the devil. What do you think of that? Introducing these corruption of innocence into the homes. What about television? Video games, internet, all of this is coming straight into the heart of the home, which should be a preservation of all of these things. So that pretty much is the prophecies I wanted to go through. There's many more prophecies. I would encourage everyone here to go after and try to find more of these prophecies and get acquainted with them. I want to mention also that the TFP every year leads a pilgrimage to Quito in February to see the statue. Go visit the place, see the incorrupt bodies, all of these things. If anybody's interested in that, come speak to me afterwards. We can talk about it. It's a February thing every year. Before we move on to the conclusion, does anybody have any questions? Yes, Rick.
Give us a synopsis on the novena, that popular novena. Was it formulated by you?
Okay, the question is, there's a novena that goes around about Our Lady of Good Success. And he's asking what the origin of it was, and I'm sorry to say I have no idea where that came from. I wish I did know, but I'm not sure. I don't think it came from Mother Mariana directly, but you know, it's a very, very popular devotion. It's a very good devotion, but unfortunately I don't know the origin of it. Anyone else have any questions? Comments? Yes, Adolfo. The government shutdown? Does that relate to Our Lady of Good Success? It's a good question. I don't think it directly does, but all of the problems that Our Lady spoke about, all the chaos in our time, it's definitely part of the same chaos and everything that exists, for sure. Rick, you had something else?
Yeah. Businesses so misunderstood. You think it's yogis standing on the same 2 hours. It's just, it's regarded as something unreal.
Yes. Yes, that's a good point. He mentioned that, you know, visions and mysticism and all of this thing is regarded as some kind of a fairy tale, something that's not real. But it is something very real. And obviously a lot of people today exaggerate it. You know, you see people, everybody you know has seen a miracle of the sun, they've seen Our Lady's face in the tree or in a grilled cheese sandwich, all of these silly things. That's not true mysticism. It does exist. It's horrible. They sold a grilled cheese on eBay that supposedly had the face of Our Lady in it and the burn marks on the bread. It's, all of these silly things give true mysticism a bad name. It's not these bizarre things. It's a very real phenomenon that exists in the church and has always existed in the church from the earliest days. Yes, Kathy?
Where would you recommend that we go to find out more about the prophecies?
More about the prophecies of Our Lady of Good Success. There are, this book right here is something that's very good. It's something that the TFP published. And what it is a book that was written by the priest who initiated and has pushed ahead the process for Mother Mariana's canonization. If anybody's interested in this book, I can take an order and bring it next time I come to Hawaii, or I can send it to you. There's also many other things. Actually, Mrs. De La Peña, Lourdes, has a very beautiful magazine called Chiesa Viva. It's an Italian priest who dedicated a whole magazine to Our Lady of Good Success. It's very well done. Very well done. You have copies, and if not, you know where you can order more.
I have copies too.
You have copies too. And you know, you can find a lot written about it on the internet as well. There's a lot of material. It's interesting because Mother Mariana was very humble, and many times she asked Our Lady, she said, I don't want these tremendous graces that I've received to be known to the world because I don't want to glorify myself. And Our Lady said, they will be hidden in the convent until the 20th century. Then they will start to disseminate throughout Ecuador and throughout the world. And that's exactly when her story started leaving the convent and going around. First time I went to Quito, you'd talk to people living in the city, walking right in front of the convent, they didn't even know the story of Our Lady of Good Success. Very, very common. So it was very much hidden devotion, but it is starting to disseminate. And Our Lady wanted it to be disseminated in our times. So I think to the extent that we can spread these apparitions, it's a very, very good thing we can do. Yes?
Was the president of Quito there, the one who was murdered?
Yes.
Did they find a prayer or a paper in his pocket expressed his prayers? Remember that?
I don't remember that. She asked if Garcia Moreno, when he was martyred, if there was a prayer in his pocket that expressed his desires. Very possibly.
One of the things he expressed was that Jesus' teachings loved him better. Mm. I thought there was more to it than
I'm sure there is, and I'm sure your story is correct. I honestly am not sure. Yes, do you know about it?
Wasn't President Garcia Moreno contemporary of Pope Pius IX?
Yes, he was. Yeah, he was a contemporary of Pope Pius IX. Absolutely, and he had many correspondence with Pope Pius IX. He supported Pope Pius IX in the time when Garibaldi was taking the Papal States from him. And if I'm not mistaken, he sent some soldiers to defend the Pope, didn't he?
He was the only head of state to send any help to the Papal States.
Okay, he was the only head of state to send any help to the Papal States, except for Jefferson Davis. But whether or not he was a head of state can be argued later. Yes.
Also, Garcia Moreno, in one of his letters, did express to the Pope that he felt that he was going to be killed.
Oh, wow. But if you didn't hear him, he said that in one of his letters that Garcia Moreno wrote to the Pope, he expressed his concern that he thought he would be killed. So, yeah, he accepted his martyrdom. He fought back when they tried to martyr them. He reached for his pistol, and they cut the fingers off of his hand. And he reached for it with the other hand, and they cut the fingers off that hand also. So he wasn't able to get at his pistol. But he was martyred. And it's actually unfortunate because Garcia Moreno very possibly could have been canonized as a saint, as a confessor of the faith. They tried to canonize him as a martyr. And to be canonized as a martyr, one of the requisites is you didn't try to stop your martyrdom. And so the canonization didn't go through and it was stopped. But I hope sincerely that the canonization process is reopened and possibly he will be canonized one day because his story is incredible. A priest by the name of Father Berth wrote an extraordinary book about the life of Garcia Moreno. Yes?
You want a comparison with the government shutdown and Garcia Moreno?
Yes.
For many years when he became president, he became president during a very bad time in Ecuador. It was financially bankrupt. And for many years into his presidency, he refused a salary until the treasury of the country
was rebuilt.
Wow.
Did everybody hear that? He said that when Garcia Moreno assumed the presidency, the government was practically bankrupt because there were a lot of problems there. And Garcia Moreno refused a salary until the treasury of the country was rebuilt. So he was very sacrificial. Correct. If we could just finish with a very brief conclusion, I'm not going to go into any detail, but I think the message of Our Lady of Good Success for us here today, living in the midst of this crisis that Our Lady foretold, is a message of profound hope, because many times we feel abandoned, we feel like somehow we veered off of God's plan. But when you see the prophecies of Our Lady, she spoke about these times. She spoke about all the terrible things that we're dealing with and confronting today. And she predicted that triumph will come afterwards. So we can't think at any time that these things we're going through right now are not part of God's plan. Our Lady knew about it. She prophesied them. She told us these things were going to happen. So when we're feeling discouraged, we can have recourse to Our Lady of Good Success. Say, yes, this is terrible, this is awful, but a restoration is coming, and it's something foreseen by God Himself and communicated us to us through the Blessed Virgin. So we have no reason for discouragement. So thank you all very much.